We'll be looking at Proverbs chapter 24 today. Chapter 24, a couple of verses there. I want to mention, as you're turning to that, we had the youth go up to Jeunesse this last weekend. They went up on Friday night and they had a youth rally, and then Saturday they raked pine needles. If you went on that trip, would you just stand up, youth? You're a youth that went. All right. I think there were 17 kids went all together. 13 kids. And 13 kids and four adults. That's a pretty good group. Pretty good group. And they got soaked. Some of them shrunk. They went up there 6'2 and came home 5'8. Oh, it was great. I praise God for what He's doing here at FSBC. Okay, Proverbs 24, verses 3 and 4. By wisdom a house is built, and by understanding it is established, and by knowledge the room are filled with all precious and pleasant riches. The Bible lifts up the family. The Bible exalts the place of the woman in the family. It's important that we understand, though, that motherhood is a ministry. It's a ministry of teaching and preparing children to follow God's pathways and be an example of the love of Jesus. That's what mothers do. That's who mothers are. And one of the things that we can see as we look around our society is that the family's under attack. The family is under attack, and the fiber of the biblically ordained family, or the foundation of the family, is being eroded by the culture that's around us. It's almost like there's a systematic kind of chipping away at that solid foundation that God has established, so that the family will collapse. The principles of God that allow His blessings to flow in our society are under attack by those who don't believe that there is God. And so they have begin to push back against those principles and make God in their own image. And all adultery is making God in our own image. And it may not be that He's an image of a human being, but He might be an image of a cow, an image of a mall, an image of a car, a house, or even the image of a family. Mothers have a very important role, as they are instrumental in bringing their children up to observe the principles and commands of God. The little one who follows me. A careful mother I ought to be, a little one is following me. I do not dare to go astray, for fear she'll go the selfsame way. I cannot once escape her eyes. Whatever she sees me do, she tries. Like me, she says she's going to be that little one who follows me. She thinks that I am good and fine, and believes in every word of mine. That's the way little guys are. I know today is Mother's Day, and we're talking about mothers specifically, but whenever we talk about mothers or whenever we talk about fathers, what we're talking about is parenting, and we're talking about family. And so many of the things that I say today to moms apply to dads. So listen, dads. And then In June, when we talk about fathers, many of the things I say to fathers are going to apply to to mothers. I use the word mother today because it's Mother's Day. The first thing I would like to point out is that in this proverb, verses 3 and 4, we're talking about family. By wisdom, a house is built. Whenever we see the word house in Scripture, it's talking about family. And it's talking about family, and I believe the immediate family. It's talking about husband and wife, and then it's talking about children, and it's also talking about extended family, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. And so the house of David would be the lineage and offshoot of David, all the descendants that come from David. So it has many meanings, this word house, but at the base and the core of what it means, it's family. It's family. And so when we talk about family, we have to understand that husband and wife are ordained by God, that every family that the Bible talks about starts with a husband and it starts with a wife. And it's a family unit that begins that way. And then the husband and the wife become mom and dad, father and mother. They have children. I believe that God ordained it that way because God's the wisest person in the universe. And He knows what we need even when we don't know what we need. And Solomon probably was the wisest man on earth, and God had him write this: two are better than one, for they have a good return for their labor. For if either of them falls, the one will lift up his companion. But woe to the one who falls when there is not another to lift him up. Furthermore, if two lie down together, they keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? And if one can overpower him who is alone, who can resist him? A cord of three strands is not quickly torn apart. You see, that cord of three strands is a husband and wife and Christ woven together into the union. Both husband and wife, father and mother, need to be found faithful to the Lord. They need to be encouraging to one another. God has made allowances. There are mothers that don't have a partner. There are single moms. There are single dads also. And God has grace for you to be able to do that and do a great job of doing what you do and bringing your children up in the love and admonition of the Lord. There is grace for that, but God's plan is for husband and wife, father and mother, to be together and encouraging each other. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, and fools despise wisdom and instruction, Proverbs 1:7 says. Well, this family idea is about building a home, about building a house, about building a legacy that loves God and has been receiving His blessings. And Psalms 127:1, the psalmist says, unless the Lord builds a house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman keeps awake in vain. Today in America, mom and dad are focused on success many times according to the world standards. They're focused on convenience according to the latest technologies. They're focused on material gain. They're focused on preparing the child for material success at the expense of spiritual success. And many times that comes because we think that The things that are most important are the things that we can control or that we can manipulate. But I want to tell you something. The most important thing, Mom, you can teach your child is the knowledge of God. The second part of this verse 3 and 4, in verse 4 it says, "And by knowledge the rooms are filled." And God has commanded this kind of knowledge in His Scripture in Deuteronomy 6, verses 6 and 7. "These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons. And you shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way, when you lie down and when you rise up." You see, God had commanded in the very early stages of the Pentateuch, in the beginning of Israel's journey, that they should teach their children the precepts and commands of God. In Psalms 78, verses 5 and 7, "For He established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which He commanded our fathers that they should teach them to their children, that the generation to come might know, even the children yet to be born." He's talking about your children, young ladies. He's talking about those children yet to be born. He's talking about those that are yet to be married and yet to start families. He's talking about when we teach our children, we're actually teaching them so that they can teach the next generation, that they may arise and tell them to their children. Teaching the knowledge of God is the most important thing we can do. Teaching others, teaching our children to fear the Lord is the most important thing we can do. Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20, "Teach them all I have taught you." Jesus puts the emphasis on teaching. In 2 Timothy 2:2, "All you disciples know that verse, and these things you have learned from me in the presence of many witnesses. These things entrust to faithful men who will in turn teach others also." Principle of teaching so that others can teach others. It's the same thing God established in the family. Teach your children so that they can teach their children about God. Discipleship is what it's all about. You see, Mom, Dad, you are discipling your children. God has given you the responsibility of teaching your children. It's not kind of sorta in the Bible. It's a command of the Bible from the very beginning that you teach your children the love of God. The most important thing you do is teach your children the love of God. I thank God for a mom that taught me about Jesus Christ. Otherwise, I would be speaking to you from prison today, probably. I was rebellious in my spirit. And the truth is, you're rebellious in your spirit too. Nobody wants to embrace God. Oh, they may want to be religious, but when they understand the requirement of God to be holy, we rebel because we want to be able to do something we can do on our own and then give it to God. God would tell us, "You got nothing I want, but you do need to receive from me." We need to teach our children the knowledge of God. We teach them with actions as well as with words. The little one who follows me that I read earlier, a careful mom I ought to be, the little one follows me. I do not dare to go astray for fear she'll go the self same way. Whatever she sees me do, she tries. Like me, she says she's going to be that little one that follows me. She thinks that I am good and fine, and she believes every word of mine. It's true. You know, when I first started pastoring, I would get to church, and it was a little bitty church in a little bitty town, and I would get up there, and I'd have to get the church opened up and get ready, and I'd go around and do certain things, and there was a little guy up there. He was my little buddy. He was about 4 years old, and he liked to get there early so he could spend some extra time with Pastor. And he even wanted his mom to take him to town and get him a suit. And so he got a little suit and tie, and he'd come to church in that suit and tie, and he had him a little New Testament, a Gideon's Bible. And he would get there, and he would follow me around. I'd go turn on lights, and he'd walk right along with me. And one day I noticed that I took my Bible, and I laid it on my desk, and he laid his Bible on the desk, and he looked over at my Bible. My Bible was laying at kind of a slant, and he picked his Bible up and turned it so that it would be sitting just like my Bible. And I thought to myself, a tear ran down my eye, and I thought, I don't know, God, if I can accept the responsibility. This little guy is watching me so close and mimicking my every move that I don't know if I can live up to that. As parents, we do that every day and don't even think about it. The little one that follows me. Heavy responsibility, knowing that someone's life is shaped by what you do and what you say. You see, children are smart enough that no matter what they say, they mimic what we do. James tells us to prove yourself doers of the word, not hearers only who delude themselves. Parents, your children ought to catch you praying. They ought to walk in on you sometimes trying to steal away to a quiet place, Mom. They ought to catch you on your knees asking God's blessing on your family, on your neighbors, on your friends, on your relatives. They ought to catch you on your knees asking God for guidance and deliverance from whatever it is that's oppressing you. They ought to walk in and catch you reading the Word. They ought to hear you quoting Scripture, Mom and Dad. And you should be doing that intentionally. They need to see faith being lived out in their parents. Not just a said faith, but an actual practicing of faith that has shoe leather on it. The Bible says in Philippians 4:7, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. 1 Peter 5:7 says, casting all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. Mom worries about everything. She worries about things that only God can control. Is it going to rain? Is it not going to rain? What if the wind blows? What if it doesn't blow? Worries about everything. The Bible says, finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is a good repute, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. The things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Mom says, if that neighbor calls, tell him I'm not home. If that boss or whoever calls, tell him I'm not home. Oh, I got extra groceries at the store. They didn't charge me for these. Oh, well, their loss. Every time something like that happens, mom, you're sending a message to your child. Our children need to see us live with integrity, to believe the relationship we have with the Lord lived out in us really makes a difference in our children's life. Knowledge needs to get from the head to the heart, and it needs to be lived out with the feet, the hands, and the mouth. The little one that follows me. And finally, then I'll close because you guys look like you're starting to get hungry. Is the riches. The riches. And by knowledge, the rooms are filled with all precious and pleasant riches. Now, the knowledge fills the rooms, and it fills the rooms with these precious riches. And the knowledge is the knowledge of God, and the rooms, I believe, are filled with children. That's my thinking. And the pleasant riches are godly children. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, "Trust the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths." Riches, rooms filled with knowledge. Knowledge of God. Children that know God. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Moms have to trust in the Lord with all their heart if they're going to raise children that are going to trust in the Lord with all their heart. When moms trust in the weatherman or the checkbook or the with all their heart, then the children begin to realize that you can't trust in God, you got to trust in yourself. It transfers. And the riches diminish. In Luke 12, 31 through 35, the scripture tells us, "But seek His kingdom, and these things will be added to you. Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has chosen gladly to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to charity. Make for yourselves money belts which do not wear out, and an unfailing treasure in heaven where no thief comes in, nor moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart is also." Think about that just for a minute. How much would you sell a child for? No amount of money could buy any one of my children. And it would take twice that much for any one of my grandchildren. That's our treasure. That's our treasure. Proverbs 1:19, 14 says, "I have rejoiced in the way of your testimonies as much as all riches." Knowledge of God. Proverbs 3, 11 through 16, "My son, do not reject the discipline of the Lord or loathe His reproof. For whom the Lord loves, He reproves. Even as a father corrects a son in whom he delights. How blessed is the man who finds wisdom and the man who gains understanding. For her profit is better than the profit of silver, and her gain is better than the fine gold. She is more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire compares with her. Long life is in her right hand, and her left hand are riches and honor." Talking about wisdom, knowledge. Wisdom and knowledge are not the same thing, but I think what wisdom is being able to put knowledge into practice. And so when you get there, you got riches. Psalms 127, 3 through 5. "Behold, children are a gift of the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward, like arrows in the hands of a warrior." Whoa. "Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth." Arrows are weapons. Offensive weapons. Children are like offensive weapons. You don't believe me? Just ask any mom. Mess with me, I'll turn my kids loose on you. I'm just messing now. How blessed is a man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be ashamed when they speak with their enemies in the gate. The riches that fill the rooms are children, godly children. You don't know how rich you are until your children have grown up and become godly parents themselves that pass on godliness to their children. Those are the riches that fill the room with paths that are directed by the Lord because they trust Him with all their hearts. Dear Lord, it's such a hectic day with little time to stop and pray. For life's been anything but calm since you called on me to be a mom. Running errands, matching socks, building dreams with building blocks, cooking, cleaning, and finding shoes, and other stuff that children lose. Fitting lids on bottled bugs, wiping tears and giving hugs. A stack of last week's mail to read, so where's the quiet time I need? Yet when I steal a minute, Lord, just at the sink or ironing board, to ask the blessings of your grace, I see then on my small one's face that you have blessed me all the while, and I stop to kiss that precious smile. And I'll close with this poem. I took a piece of plastic clay and idly fashioned it one day. And as my fingers pressed it still, it moved and yielded at my will. I came again when days were past, the form I gave it still it bore. But as my fingers pressed it still, I could change that form no more. I took a piece of living clay and gently formed it day by day and molded with my power and art a young child's soft and yielding heart. I came again when days were gone. It was a man I looked upon, and still that early impress bore, and I could change it never more. You see, moms, you only have so much time to mold the heart of your child. I forgot to change my... And so it's very important that while God has made it so that you have time while they're elastic and impressionable to mold them, that He's commanded you to do that. And so if you don't do it during that time, it's like cement that sets up and it gets hardened and it's not so easy to mold anymore. Very, very important responsibility. Much like the little guy that followed me around the church and wanted to lay his Bible just like I laid mine, I realized that every word I spoke, he listened to and would emulate, at least for that time while he was little. And then I realized how much more significant it was that I had children that looked at me the same way. Moms, it's an overwhelming job. I can't tell you how often I thank God that He's made me a dad. But God never intended for me to be a dad by myself, and He never intended for you to be a mom by yourself. He intended for us to cry out to Him to lead us, guide us, guard us, use us in that capacity so that the job would get done right. Because you see, God always intended on being added in the mix. Use you to accomplish His purpose in your child's life. Because the only person in the universe that loves your child more than you is God. I'm going to ask you to stand. I'm going to pray. And then we're going to have a hymn of invitation. I'm going to ask the girls to come. Get ready. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank You in Your wisdom that You created man and woman. Thank You in Your wisdom that You created family. Thank You in Your wisdom that You created the body of Christ and gave us a way through Him to be counted worthy. As we come before Your throne this morning, we thank You for our mothers. We thank You for the influence they had on our lives. We thank You, Heavenly Father, for allowing us to come to Your throne of grace and give You thanks. We would ask today that as we look back, that we would be thankful, and as we look ahead, we would be excited. Because not only do You direct our paths, but You direct the future. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing Come As You Are. I don't know what the Lord said to you today. Maybe you just need to come up and pray. Maybe you would need to rededicate yourself to the Lord and say, hey, I need to get on board and go. Maybe you would come and say, I need to invite Christ in my heart today. Whatever the Lord would ask you to do, we want to encourage you, and we would like you to be an encouragement to us. Won't you come?